everyone. This afternoon's seminar is on Zoom, the wonderful new video conferencing and virtual classroom application that is just becoming more and more a part of our everyday lives here at SDCCD Online and all across the district. We're going to start off talking a little bit about what Zoom can do, and the technology behind it, and how to make it do that. And then we're going to talk a little bit about how we might make use of it, particularly in the classroom. Let me start off by introducing myself. I'm Dave Giberson. I'm one of the instructional design coordinators at SDCCD Online, the Online Learning Pathways Division at the district. And I've met most of you at one time or another. It's great to have you here this afternoon. And I'm the person who's probably as excited about Zoom as anyone here. And I am thrilled to share Zoom with you this afternoon and hope that you'll be just as excited about it when we get done. I'd like to start off by asking each of you in turn to introduce yourselves. If you don't have a microphone, you can use the chat tool, which you can access by mousing over me, over the video window, and you should see a menu pop up at the bottom of the screen. We'll be talking about that menu a lot today. But one of the things in that menu is a chat tool about halfway along there. And if you click that chat tool, you can simply type and press enter, and we'll all see your message. Hopefully most of you have microphones. It'll be much better to hear you as well as see you type. And if you have a webcam, I'd encourage you to turn that on. You can do that using in the same menu using the little camera icon in the lower left corner, which will allow you to start and stop your video. Well, but particularly when you're introducing yourself, if you don't mind. And I'm going to go into what's called gallery view so that I can see you all at one time. You'll find a button to do that if you mouse over the screen in the upper right-hand corner of the screen. Gallery view. Or it may just be a little tic-tac-toe board looking thing if it's shrunk down, depending on how big you have the window. And if you click on that, you'll be able to see everyone at once. All righty. I'm just going to go left up from the upper left to the lower right in my display. Ingrid, how about you? Can you unmute
yourself? Okay. Hi, everyone. I'm Ingrid Greenberg, and I'm an ESL instructor.
Thank you. Eric, how about you? Eric Miller. Okay, Eric, you're muted. You'll unmute yourself down the lower left-hand corner. There you are.
Hi, I'm Eric Miller, an ESL instructor at Mid-City.
Thank you. Glenn, how about you?
Steve Gwynn, vessel instructor at Mid-City.
Thanks, Steve. Glenn Abrams, how about you?
Hi, I'm an IMCP online instructor out of North City Center.
Great, thanks. Jay Newcomb.
Sorry, I didn't know whether you said that. Hi, I'm Jay Newcomb.
Wonderful things about Zoom, just a second, Jay. I see that look on your face.
I was too busy looking at the chat. I'm Jane Newcomb, and I teach IMCP at North City Center, and I'm also the Continuing Ed Online Mentor.
Thank you. Michelle.
Hi, I'm Michelle Fishball. You've been getting emails from me. I'm the lead dean responsible for online education, distance education for continuing education. Up until 2 months ago, I was dean of the Business and Information Technology Program, and now I'm the dean of Institutional. And welcome, everyone. I'm glad you're all here.
Thank you. Christina.
Hi, my name is Christina. I'm an ESL instructor at Miramar College, and I teach level 4 down there.
Oh, great. Claudia? Oops. We're not getting audio from you, Claudia.
Yeah, I'm in a busy campus, UCLA, with a lot of students in the back.
Oh, great. Now we hear you.
So it's pretty noisy around me. So I'm an emeritus instructor for continuing education, and I'm also the chair of continuing education's Academic Senate Ad Hoc Distance Education Committee. I really practice that. It's a long time. name for a committee.
And also illustrating another bit of the power of Zoom. It looks like you're using your phone coming to us from a location outside where you probably don't even have Wi-Fi.
Yeah, I couldn't find a room. So, yeah, I do have Wi-Fi. I'm using my computer, but it's just a sitting area of all the students here.
Zoom works just about anywhere. Cool.
Oh, yeah.
That's great. I couldn't have arranged that any better. Thank you. Okay, Margaret.
Hi, I'm Margaret, and I teach ESL at Mid-City.
Welcome. Julia. Is Julia with us? Julia, you may need to unmute yourself. Icon in the lower left-hand corner looks like a microphone.
She actually introduced herself on chat.
Oh, very good. Wonderful. Thank you, Michelle. Excellent. All right. Is that Don?
One more, Suzanne Swirsky. I'm also here. I can't get my camera to work.
Oh, okay. No problem. Are you hearing us and seeing us okay?
Yeah, I am, and I teach in the Emeritus Program, Communications and Social Studies.
Excellent. Okay, Don Aragon, I think.
Hi, my name is Don Aragon. I'm a vid instructor at North City.
Welcome. Thanks for being here. And Stephanie. Okay, Stephanie's mic is disabled, but she just sent us a chat message there. Generally, you will see those messages pop up if they're sent to you or to the entire group, so that's great. Very good. All right, now we've just taken roll. Very, hopefully, low-impact way. It's one way for us to remember who showed up. Very good. Let's take a look. First off, make sure I don't, just to give you an idea of how this is going to go today. All right, we've already gone through our introductions. I'm going to start off by showing you how to use Zoom, going through the basics of the interface. We've already done a good bit of that just in communicating with one another. I think you're already seeing how useful this tool can be and how natural it can be to communicate using it. The feel that you get for this is just so much more natural than most online collaboration systems. It's also exceptionally reliable and very flexible. You can use it in a lot of different ways, and we'll cover all of that today. then I'm going to show you what you need to know to moderate, to start, populate, and moderate your own Zoom sessions so that you can go right away and use this with your students, with your colleagues, however you wish to use it. Then we'll talk about some of the pedagogy. Let me get over here and push up the document camera there, or the document. We're going to talk about some of the things that we might do with Zoom instructionally. Obviously, it's a wonderful meeting tool, and that's what it was originally designed or conceived for. But it also has amazingly powerful instructional applications, and that's really what we're here to talk about today. Just a few house rules here. I don't need to be the only one talking here. I dearly hate to talk for 2 hours without respite. I'm a teacher just like all of us, and I can do it if I have to. That's a threat. But I do hope that you will jump in. If you're in a noisy area or if you're doing something else and rustling papers and things like that, it'd be helpful if you kept yourself muted. That mute button is in the lower left-hand corner of the screen. If you move your mouse over the screen, you'll see it. So it looks like a little microphone. But if you're in a quiet area and sitting quietly, just leave that unmuted so you can just jump right in. I really don't mind being interrupted. It's always a mercy for everyone else, and even for me. Sometimes it's hard to get my break the linkage between the spine and the mouth that tends to keep me yammering on. So please, especially if you can't see something I'm talking about, or if I seem to be referring to things I laid no foundation for, anything like that, please just jump right in, and I will be delighted. All right, we're really not going to stand on ceremony today, and this is going to be much more effective if it's more of a dialogue than a lecture. That is just absolutely one bit of pedagogical lore that I believe to be 100% true. We all learn better if we all participate, so please jump in. Whenever you have a question, or if you just something strikes you and you think it's apropos to the moment, jump in, please. All right, those are the ground rules. Let's see, where are we? Back here. All right, we've covered a good bit of the Zoom basics already. You know about, let me get myself back up here again. That's another view. You know about the video, know that you can see one another as long as you have a webcam. And but you don't have to have a webcam in order to participate in a Zoom meeting. So it really enriches everyone's experience. If you do have one, I urge you to turn it on. Even if you don't like the way you look on the webcam, people look at you every day. This is just another natural interaction. And no one can see you who's not a part of the meeting, so don't worry about it. The NSA is not watching, I really don't think. obviously, we can talk back and forth just as naturally as we could if we were standing next to one another. And in fact, look who's here.
We are. Hi, everybody.
Hey, Katie.
Hi.
Thanks.
Sure. Hi, Katie.
Hello.
Katie just came back from a presentation at the language conference at Mesa this morning, so she'll hopefully be joining us here in a little bit on the call. But the interaction, again, perfect example. The interaction is so natural, so informal, much better than most meetings, to tell you the truth. Not only do you not have to travel to sit in a room with people, but it's more fun, it's more comfortable, and often enough you can hear and see things better than you can face to face. That's a pretty powerful thing. As far as the basics of using the interface, we've already talked about how to mute yourself, how to turn your video on and off, how to use chat, run through quite a bit of that. You may have noticed here that, we'll do that in a moment. I think you're beginning to see then that you could do most anything with Zoom that you can do in a classroom. You can talk to your students. If they have webcams, you can see them. I love that interaction with Jane where I could tell that she hadn't heard what I said because I could see her. I could see the look in her eyes. I knew that what I had said hadn't registered. Just as you can do with students in a classroom, you can see who's alert, who's sleeping, especially who's confused. That most important of all keys that we use when we're lecturing live. You know, you can just scan the class at a glance and know when you've lost them. And you can do that with Zoom, too. And that's one of the things I most miss in online collaboration tools like this. Not knowing whether the people on the other end are really seeing what you think they're seeing or understanding what you're trying to say, or at least think they are. And without that feedback, very difficult to give an effective lecture or an effective help session or whatever. And Zoom gives you that capability. If you pull up gallery view, you can see everyone. And I mean everyone who has a webcam. These Zoom sessions, the standard Zoom Pro sessions, will hold 50 people. The one we're using right now, we have one large room, will hold 100. And you can get an account that will hold up to 200. And while you can't see all those webcams on the screen at one time, they'd be pretty tiny. If once more than about 25 people get on the call, you get multiple screens of webcams in gallery view, and you can swipe between them. You just move one off and another, you can scroll through them pretty quickly. So you can, but in most meetings where you have fewer than 25 people, you can just sweep the group at a glance, and you know what's going on in your classroom. That is so, so big. That's one of the nicest features and one of the biggest advantages I think Zoom has over other systems of its type. It also happens to be one of the cheapest ones out there. This is one of those cases where cheap does not mean poorer in quality. It's also the best one I know. So that's a pretty powerful combination. All right, so we see what we can do with Zoom very quickly. It's really impressive, but what do we need to do that? What is it going to cost us to do that? The answer is not much. I've already said the software is inexpensive. You can actually get a free, let me bring up the equipment list here. Talk about that now. Got too many cameras here. There we go. The software itself is quite inexpensive. It is, indeed, you can get a free Zoom account whose only limitation is that your meetings can't be longer than 40 minutes. That doesn't sound like a real bad idea, does it? That's not necessarily a limitation. That may be could be considered an enforced best practice, particularly when I'm blathering on. But what they don't tell you is that if you get a little sound there from somebody.
Dave, can I tell you about the 40-minute rule?
Please.
I've been doing that one because I'm using my my other school one that I set up myself, which is 40 minutes. But it's helped me keep the meeting short and concise. And if we need to continue on, we just, you know, start it again. And so far, we've been able to just to get everything in 40 minutes. And it really saves, you know, lingering time and what have you. So it has its pros and cons. But that I wanted to give a good pro for that one.
Oh, thank you. That is so true. It's kind of like what Jack Welch did when he took over at General Electric. Before he decreed that all meetings would be standing, that you couldn't sit down and have a meeting. And this is another way of enforcing that, though. Fortunately or unfortunately, as Jane mentioned, what Zoom doesn't tell you is that you can just start another meeting and everybody can just join again and you can keep going for another 40 minutes. So that's not much of a limitation. If you want to avoid that hassle, it costs you $15 a month. For a 50-attendee, unlimited license. You can have as many meetings as you wish, and they can be as long as you wish, God forbid. And that's, you know, $15 a month, about what it costs you for HBO. So not a bad deal. In terms of equipment, you've got to have certain basics. Let me see if I can get camera 2 on here. Yeah, there we go. You've got to have a computer, okay? I'm using, obviously, a laptop here. That's convenient in many cases because you also, at minimum, if you're going to originate a Zoom session, you really need a webcam and a microphone. And most laptops these days have those built in. If you don't happen to have one built in, you can use an external webcam like this one here. We like the Logitech C920. It's about a $70 webcam. It has amazing video quality. Let me show you that one. Oops, that's not it. Excuse me, that's the wrong one. There's the C920 that's sitting right in front of me. It'll do up to 1080. High definition video, and it has marvelous audio. It's got a marvelous microphone in it as well. That's the microphone I've been using all along here. So that takes care of both the needs of the webcam and the microphone in one package, and it will work with any computer, Mac or PC. Terrific. A nice trick is to put if you have an external webcam, is to put it on a little tripod, which you can get for, 10 or 20 bucks. A little tabletop tripod, which gives you the ability to swing it around on your audience or point it at something that you want your students to see other than you. And those are your basic requirements. Absent or beyond the computer, then you're talking about less than a couple hundred bucks to get started with a Zoom classroom. Optionally, oops, sorry about that. Get it straightened out in time. It's nice to have two webcams. I've obviously got quite a few here, and Zoom will accommodate, I know, at least four or five webcams at one time. We've had that many on it already. And you can easily switch between them. If you mouse over your screen again, we take a look at you can see the little, in the lower left corner, you can see the little microphone icon. Then you see a little up caret next to that. That is the audio control center. If you click the little up caret, it won't hurt anything. I'm sorry I can't show you what I'm doing right now because this doesn't transmit. But if you click that little up caret just to the right of the mute button, you'll see a list of microphones and speakers and then an audio options menu that allows you to massage your audio during the meeting. But if you have multiple microphones, you can select between them. I do. I have three different microphones active here right now. And the one I'm using is the one in the webcam. I've just switched to another one. You can probably tell the difference in audio at this point. That is a video conferencing microphone. It's a little microphone that you've probably seen in audio conferencing or attached to audio conferencing telephones and things like that. It's a little trapezoidal microphone that I don't need to show you right now, but it's about $70. And the great advantage it has is if you're in a situation where you have students online and students in a classroom, that microphone will allow people in the classroom to communicate directly with people online and vice versa, back and forth. It will pick up audio from up to about 20, 25 feet away quite nicely. And then if you have speakers attached to your computer, of course, if people remotely speak, people in the classroom hear it, and when people in the classroom speak, remote students hear it. So you can have a true class discussion on Zoom that doesn't have to funnel through you, the instructor. That was about $80. So none of this hardware is especially expensive. I've already mentioned the tripod, and it's nice to have back here, remember what you're seeing. It's nice to have a little document camera as well. This is an IPEVO, I-P-E-V-O, point-to-view camera, and that's in this document here. And I'll put a link to that document in the chat here in a few minutes when we take a break. That allows me to share documents with you, books, paper documents, three-dimensional objects, and it allows me to, in effect, have a whiteboard in real time. Let me show you what I mean by that. In order to show you that, I'm going to have to illustrate probably the other most critical capability of Zoom, and that is the ability to share your computer screen. I mean, it's wonderful to talk to your students. It's wonderful for your students to see you. But there are times when you need to share visuals with them. PowerPoint presentations, documents, a piece of hardware. Or you need to get up and you need to draw on the whiteboard. Or you need to do something that's equivalent to that. Because particularly in STEM fields, math, science, technology, sometimes there's just no substitute for being able to draw something. Or being able to draw mathematical symbols. We just don't have a really good way of putting those on the computer screen. So all of that's important. So I'm going to share my screen with you now. It's real simple. In fact, you can do it as well, though I'd ask you to wait until I finish doing mine. Then we'll let each of you do it in turn if you like. If you mouse over the video window again, you'll see that menu. And right smack dab in the menu is a little green highlighted green icon that says Share Screen. And if I pop that icon, I get a little dialog box popping up that gives me a number of options of things that I can share. For instance, there's an interactive whiteboard. If you like to share, if you want to draw a diagram and have your students annotate it or add to it, you can do that. You can share any window that you have open on your desktop. But generally, the easiest and most comprehensible thing to do is to take the default and to share your desktop, which means that anything that you see on your computer screen, your attendees will see. And that is normally in the upper left-hand corner of the options. and it will say desktop. And it will be normally highlighted in green when, as soon as you click screen, share screen, you'll see that highlighted in green. And then there will be a share screen button down the lower left-hand corner. Now, before I do that, let me let you play with that. Why don't you, this is a kind of a two barrels sort of, or two trigger sort of thing. You pull the first trigger and it gives you the options that you have to share. And then you pull the second trigger and it goes off and it actually shares the screen. So why don't you click share screen, and this is what I'm talking about. You'll see a dialog box with a whiteboard, variety of other things. And up in the upper left-hand corner, you'll see your desktop. Please don't click the little blue share screen button down in the lower right-hand corner yet, since I'm about to share mine. But that's what I'm going to do now. I'm going to click that little share screen button down in the lower right-hand corner. You can just close that window by clicking on the X in the upper right-hand corner. So there's my computer desktop, Windows 10 machine, nothing special going on. But if I start a little application here that's attached to my, we started off talking about the document camera here, right? Well, there is a little document camera. I'm gonna make that bigger so you can see it better. That document camera sends this right to the to my screen, which Zoom then sends to you all. And here's our outline here. Let's see how we're doing. We're a little over a half an hour in, and we are sort of here. Not too bad. We've covered some of this other stuff already as well. So I'm going to call that a victory. But that's, and not only can I show you a pre-done document, but I can put a blank piece of paper under there. I can pick up trusty Sharpie. A medium point marker is good, so make things a little bolder for your students to see. So if I have a, say, a mathematical equation, 2x squared plus 3 equals 11. Well, I can, you know, we can work through how to solve that. I can subtract 3 from each side. Feel free to tell me if I get this wrong. I can't reasonably take my shoes off and count on my toes here. So 2x squared equals 8. So x squared equals, if I divide both sides by 2, x squared equals 4. So the square root of x squared is equal to the square root of 4. As long as I do the same thing to both sides of the equation, I'm kosher, right? So x is equal to 2, right? Gee, that worked out. Not higher mathematics, obviously, but that's about as far as I trust myself in a live situation. And that's something that's very hard to share any other way. You about have to have a whiteboard, but there it is. And your students can see it better than they can in the classroom, because they're not squinting at a whiteboard that hasn't been erased in 3 weeks with a dry erase marker that's on its last legs. This just works. So, whiteboard. All right, let's see here. And that about covers the even the nice to haves. So for another couple $100, you could really be rocking and rolling. That's really all you have to do to provide an experience to your remote students that's every bit as robust as what you can provide to students in
who are physically present in the classroom. And those students can be anywhere in the world. They can be comfortable without having to add to the traffic on the roads. And they can access this from any computer that's attached to the internet, or even better, they can access it from their smartphones or their tablets wirelessly. As a matter of fact, the computer I'm broadcasting from right now is attached to the wireless, to the district wireless network here at in the W building at Miramar. I know I didn't even bother to plug it in. I could have plugged it into the wired network if I wanted to, but it's not necessary. Zoom is so comfortable on wireless and operates at such a wide range of bandwidths that I don't have to worry much about that. But you can, as you saw with Claudia, you can access Zoom from anywhere using just about any kind of device that will access the web, be it a laptop, be it a desktop computer, or a smartphone. Just to give you an idea here. Oops. Credit card bill. I'd be more than happy to share that if somebody wanted to pay it. Don't need to call anybody. There's a free Zoom app available for both iOS, this is an iPhone, obviously, or Android. Works equally well on either one. And joining a meeting on this is nothing. Your students do not have to have, as you didn't, don't have to have Zoom accounts. All you have to do is provide them with one of two things. One of those possibilities is a so-called meeting ID. It's a multi-digit number that you can put in an email or send it to them, or provide it to them in any number of ways online. And if you start your session properly, and we'll see how to do that in a moment, that ID will not change. You can make it change if you want to, if you want a meeting that, you know, is not, that does not use your published ID, you can do that. But normally, you want to make it easier for people to get in. And all I have to do to join this meeting on my phone is to tap join a meeting here and type in the number, which is 825-466-9471. That's my personal meeting ID. Bingo. I am not going to join the audio because if I do that, I'll set up a feedback loop. But now, what I'm seeing right now is my, and because this is going to infinity here, but you can see behind there that what's displayed is that path problem I just did. That's what I'm seeing on my screen, just as clearly as I could as I can on the computer screen. A little smaller, but very doable. And if I stop that share, that's one click. Now there's a new person on the, if you go into gallery view, you'll be able to see me. And there I am on my phone. And if I didn't have it muted because I'm sitting right next to my other microphone, which would set up a horrible feedback loop, you'd be able to hear me just as clearly as you can hear me through this system. Not only can you attend a Zoom meeting perfectly effectively on your cell phone, and see and hear everything that you hear on your computer, or that you would see and hear in the classroom, you can even, in a pinch, originate, even hold class from your cell phone while sitting on the beach, as long as there's a cell tower somewhere nearby, because this works over cellular just beautifully. I have held Zoom meetings running at 80 miles an hour down I-15 in the passenger seat of my car. I wasn't driving at the time. That would be an exceptionally bad idea, let me make that clear. But and it worked great. Once in a while, when we switch from one cell tower to another, the picture would freeze for a second and come right back. Zoom's unbelievably robust and amazingly flexible. Okay, I'm going to go ahead and leave the meeting on my phone, lest it accidentally activates the microphone. We got craziness there. So, let's see. Questions?
Sharing your screen. Dave, what happens if somebody else wants to share their screen? Do you have to give them permission, or can they share and would it just take over?
No, they will. They'll have to wait for me to unshare, to unhog. And by default in Zoom, the screen sharing is available to everyone. But if someone shares their screen, I don't want them to. I can go in and go to Manage Participants down in the menu down at the bottom and shut them off if I have to. I've never had to. But no, you don't have to worry about that. If you're sharing, it will stay. It will be, if you try to share while I'm sharing, you just get a message that says, the moderator is sharing. It's great.
I also see an option to share your iPhone or iPad. What does that do?
If you have AirPlay set up and you're in a wireless environment, wireless network environment, and some killjoy at the district hasn't disabled peer-to-peer connections on the network, you can actually share your screen from your iPhone or your tablet. Your iPad. You can also do that, as I showed you, with the document camera, but it's a little slicker the other way. I can't demonstrate that to you because that capability is turned off on our Wi-Fi for security reasons. There are good reasons to do that, but try it at home. You can do it at home. Good question, Will. Anybody else? That's when this gets really interesting.
Okay. Dave, I have a question.
Great.
Could you demonstrate the whiteboard?
Yeah, surely. Share myself here.
I guess that's a request.
That's great. Those are even better. Okay, here we have a shared whiteboard. We have some drawing tools up the top. I can select draw and a weight of the stroke and a color. I'll try red. And I can just, using my mouse, or if I have a graphics tablet, that'd be even neater. Now somebody else try it. If you go push to the top, your mouse to the top of the screen, you'll see some annotation tools come down. It's even easier to do on a phone.
I do get a message that says you cannot start screen share while other participant is sharing.
Let's see, somebody got it. Very good. Now we're getting there. Yeah, you don't want to share your screen, but those annotations will be available at the top of your screen if you mouse on top, as I see lots of you are finding. And I can share it and make you start again. This could get out of hand in a hurry. So you can put, it's mainly a curiosity if you're drawing with your mouse because it's really hard to control a mouse in this way. But if you have a little Wacom tablet, a little graphics tablet, which you can get for under $100 now. You can actually draw with a stylus, and you can do a pretty good job, especially with a little practice. And the results can be a lot of fun. And these annotation tools are not just available in the whiteboard. If I stop the share.
So Dave, I missed that entirely. How do I get to draw on your whiteboard?
I'll let somebody else answer that who was
paying attention
on my whiteboard.
Well, it's Michelle. I was trying to write you a message on the board. There was up top, there was a pull down, and it said annotate. You had to click on that. Can you go back to whiteboard, Dave?
That's it.
Can you go back to it so that the pull down shows?
Yeah. Share that again. Yeah. Oh.
So if you bring your mouse up to where it says you are viewing Dave's screen, and then under options, there's an annotate.
So Dave, I must have a different configuration on my screen because I don't see that as an option.
Even if you move your mouse up there?
I think if I go into full screen mode.
Try that.
That works.
Okay, good. Oh, it's working all too well. okay, enough fun, no more fun. We're stopping the fun. Okay.
That's the first bit of interactivity, Dave. Come on.
Yeah, that's right. And if I share my desktop, annotate that too. And as can I, if you push your mouse to the top of the screen, a little bar will drop down and there's an annotate option in it, and I can draw on my screen. So I can circle the equation there, or piece of my iPhone, or whatever, right over the top of that, and everybody sees it. And yes, there is a way to disable annotation by everybody else. if you need to, I shan't be a buzzkill in that regard. At least everything has been reasonably clean so far. You never know with this group, I tell you. Okay. Let me get back to another view here.
Did you just say you never know about us being reasonably clean? No.
Oh, very good. So Zoom is fun. If you don't get anything else out of this seminar, know that. Because as long as you know it's fun, you can figure all this technical stuff out. There's really nothing to using Zoom. You just have to play with it a little bit to get comfortable with it, figure out where the buttons and the lights are and so on. Okay. All right. Moderating a session, you have a few capabilities if you're the moderator, obviously, that you don't have if you're a participant. One thing you can do is manage participants. You have that option too, but I have tools that you don't have. Let me describe those to you, since I can't really show them since I don't transmit. If you mouse over the screen, click Manage Participants at the bottom, I see we have 15 people in the session right now. That's marvelous. It gives you a list of everybody who's in the session. That's worth having simply to keep track of who showed up. I think I just recorded that. But also, there are, let's see, Suzanne, there's something you needed to say. I'm sorry.
I'm here. You call me.
Hi, Riku. I can lower that hand. I can mute and unmute people. At me. There's some noise going on or something like that that I can't, so that becomes a problem. I can mute some people. I can also, if I mouse over the person, I get the option to chat with them. I can ask them to, give them the capability to record, as I did to Eric earlier. I can make someone the host. If I want to give you my all of my capabilities, I can make you the host. Or I can remove someone from the meeting if I have to. Never had to do that. Don't anticipate it today. And another thing that you will see, that I'm seeing, that you will see if you're the moderator, is you can assign someone to close caption. Not doing that today because it's very expensive. And we do not yet have a mechanism with DECT, with the Distance Education Captioning Transcription Grant and CCC Confer to get a real-time caption in the session. But that's coming. We're working on that. And the capability is already built into Zoom. So that would allow us to have a window that's accessible to whomever needs it with the dialogue typed out in real time. Real-time captioners are generally moonlighting court reporters. And they can give you word for word what's going on in real time. They have to be able to do that in the courtroom. And that capability exists. Zoom will accommodate that, which is something we had to have before we could really start using it effectively. Okay? So those are all, there are a number of things that you can do to maintain control of the session if you have to. Obviously, like I say, I've never had to do any of that, except occasionally I've had to mute someone when they didn't realize that this sound that sounded soft to them in the background was coming through so clearly that it was interfering with everyone else hearing what was going on in the meeting. But that's unusual, too. Zoom has an excellent echo cancellation capability. It will cut out much of that kind of problem. It's really not especially vulnerable to that sort of thing. Any other questions before we move on to something else here? Let's see if I'm chat. Like there are a couple in there since I've looked at it.
Dave, I have a comment that just happened to me that happened on my first meeting, and it freaked me out. I clicked somewhere, and my whole screen disappeared, and I couldn't figure out how to get it back. I clicked all over. I looked all over, and what I had to do is go up to meeting, and it shows you enter full screen or enter minimal view screen, and I, for I don't know how I got to enter with no screen, but that's how you bring it back if that happened. Right. So under meeting, there's enter full screen if you lose your screen.
Also, if you don't have your Zoom window full screen and you accidentally click outside it on your desktop, it can, you know, it'll minimize down to the taskbar in Windows or on the Mac.
Yeah.
And if that happens, there's a little Zoom icon in your taskbar at the bottom, a little stylized white camera on a blue field that you can click on to bring it back. Yes, that happens to me with regularity. Where'd that go? Also, if you have a fairly complex setup where you have multiple cameras and so on, you can lose track of what your attendees are seeing. One way to minimize that possibility is to stay in meeting or in gallery view much of the time so you can see what everybody else is seeing of you. But it can be problematic. So that's one of the, why I said at the beginning, if you hear me talking about something and you can't see it, let me know right away, because probably it means I think you can see it and you can't. One thing you can do to minimize that sort of problem is to log in using another computer or your phone or an iPad or something and put that off to the side so that you can see what your attendees are seeing in real time. I had a great message here asking about cost of Zoom. Will the district ever support Zoom financially? Well, we're doing that already to a degree. Online Learning Pathways has 20 Zoom Pro accounts that we are allowing faculty and staff to share. That means that you don't, it's not dedicated to you, but the chances of two people needing to use it at exactly the same time have proved to be quite remote. We almost never have those kind of conflicts. So multiple people can share the same account, they can log in, and I'm going to show you here in a minute one thing I haven't done up to now is show you how to start a Zoom meeting, which that's very simple, but I'm going to show you how to do it. And I'll show you how to schedule a meeting. And if, as long as you schedule your meetings in advance, if you know when they're going to be, you can mark out, you can reserve that time, and the people who are sharing the account with you will presumably honor that. Otherwise, we'll find someone else to share your account with you. It is, at this moment, 2:32. I just as in any long presentation like this, we hate to keep people glued to their seats for more than an hour at a time. So let's say we'll take a 5-minute break here, and we'll resume at 2:37. Did I have that up right?
There's some irony there. Did he just freeze?
Pardon?
Uh-oh. Yeah, he did.
I did freeze there for a second.
Did freeze?
He's back. He's back now.
Yeah, my internet connection, my wireless connection went a little wonky on me there for a minute. I got this message on the screen. I was looking at the camera instead of the screen, so sorry about that. Maybe I will plug that wire in while we're resting. But let's say 2:38, and we'll be back. Give everybody a chance. Oh, Christina, no problem. I certainly understand if you got to leave if you have to leave to pick up your kids, do not worry about that.
Yeah, the little ones are getting off school today a little bit earlier.
Hey, it's a Zoom. I mean, you can come and go as you please. And remember, we're recording this. You can pick up at this point and watch it again later.
Hi, Dave. Can you hear me?
Yes, I can.
This is Emma. I don't have a phone. I have no camera. I'm in my classroom.
No problem. We can hear you great, though.
Okay, good.
As long as you can hear and see me, you're in great shape.
Yeah, great.
Yeah, Zoom's very flexible. You can attend. You can even attend by just dialing a telephone number to get the audio.
Right. That's what I understand. Yeah.
Yeah. So it's
How about smartphone? Smartphone too? Smartphone or no?
Absolutely. There's an app that makes your smartphone, the experience on the smartphone with the free app is almost as good as the experience on the computer.
Oh, wow. Okay.
I've very often had to attend meetings if I've been traveling or something on my smartphone.
Uh-huh.
and the experience is every bit as effective.
And how about iPad?
iPads, any mobile, any Android okay. or iOS device
okay.
will run the Zoom app.
Okay. Awesome.
Just look in your app store, and it's the app icon is a stylized white camera on a blue field.
Okay.
One thing that is called Zoom, and some of those are not exactly instructional in the manner that we define the word.
Excuse Dave, I have a question
please.
For you. Oh, Dave?
Yeah.
I wanted to, do I need to make an appointment to come into that, the Miramar, the, where, you know, where your classroom is in the warehouse building? Do I need to make an appointment or is it, open lab?
Anytime.
Okay.
But, you know, we do occasionally get called away or something like that. It's probably a good idea just to call just to make sure we're there.
Okay.
We don't already have somebody working with somebody else at that time. But the format, we try not to stand on ceremony. We're always happy to see.
Okay, great.
And this setup that I've been showing you here is available for you to use.
It's beautiful. Spotlight.
we're leaving this more or less set up all the time now. We have uh-huh. our production lab dedicated
production.
To
uh-huh.
the studio. And we hope that people will come in and use it. You can broadcast your class from here.
Great.
We also
okay.
have another little studio room down the hall that is smaller and a little bit more private for use as well.
Okay.
It's, we're trying to outfit them both fully. Right now we kind of have one complete set of equipment, part of another, and we're working on that. But we can certainly accommodate you in that regard, yes.
Great. It's a nice background there. There's mist behind you.
Well, sort of.
I like the one with the ocean view.
Would rather be in the ocean? All right.
Yeah.
Let's see. Let's see what we can do about that.
Dave, I have a question.
Please.
You mentioned before that you can record the sessions. What is the format that comes out this recording? Is an MP4?
MP4 video file, standard MP4 video file.
Okay.
I'll show you how that works here in a minute.
Okay. So after recording, does Zoom process the recording and converts it to the MP4? Or there's anything else that you have to do?
No, it converts it to the MP4.
Okay.
Then you can just take that, if you want to share that MP4, you can just upload it to YouTube directly.
Okay, great.
And we've been doing 3-hour seminars, which, amazingly enough, people have sat through. I still can't believe it.
I know.
The rule on online stuff is keep it short. Find that rule. And people have been sitting there for 3 hours. Oh, some of them start to look a little... go into gallery view, you can see the total in about 2 hours. But those 3-hour videos upload to YouTube and YouTube captions them and everything, just great.
Thank you.
Good questions. Again, let's come back to that idea of cost and Zoom. So we're providing those Zoom Pro accounts for free. We pay for them. They don't cost us that much. For 20 accounts where one of them has a 100-person room, we're paying $1,500 or $1,600 a year, which for software and services like that is chicken feed. You pay 10 times that for Blackboard Collaborate, for instance, which sucks by comparison. Say that? Is this being recorded? Sorry.
It's beautiful.
It's very inexpensive. The captioning, I had a question on that. Real-time captioning is really expensive. But that is covered by the DECT grant, the Distance Education Captioning and Transcription Grant, provided by the State Chancellor's Office. And you can collaborate right now. You've got a real-time captioner in a session, especially if we have hearing impaired students. That capture in there for free for to us. Grant pays the whopping part of that. And that is technically also possible with Zoom, though they haven't worked out the logistical side of it yet. But I've been in touch with Michelle and at CCC Confer, and they are working on that. But that will happen. So it's that's not a cost we have to worry about. And the cost of Zoom, Zoom's about the least expensive service that you'll ever see. And as I said, it's about the best in class. There really aren't any that are better. Most are not nearly as good. And by just about every measure, we, of course, have access to Blackboard Collaborate through CCC for free. But here by comparison, to use, and especially a nightmare for our students. If I can cut out some of that noise there. It's just very, very, very easy for the students to use. In a Collaborate session, a CCC Confer session, we almost always have at least one or two people who can't get in who want to. With Zoom, that almost never happens. It's top-notch. All righty. I think I've gotten most of that in the chat answered there. Now, one thing I don't want to forget to do is show you how to start the Zoom session. We've done most of the stuff under moderation here. Let me get that back up. Remind you of what we're trying to do here. Obviously, we have a somewhat more somewhat more complex setup here than you would normally have in your classroom. But as I mentioned during the break, this setup is available to you if you want to come up here. We're based at Miramar in the W Building, the District Computer Center and Warehouse. And you're welcome to come up and use this setup. It's really not difficult to use at all. And one of the things we have here is a nice document camera that I'm using right now that we got for free because someone at one of the colleges surplused it. I picked it out of the auction pile downstairs before it got sold off for scrap. And, okay, here we are. We've done screen sharing, managed participants, we've chatted, we're talking about recording. I talked about closed captioning. Don't want to forget something here. But one thing I haven't done yet somehow is show you how to start a session. That's real simple. I can show you that in about a moment. I'll share my screen again here. And flip to, let me get the IPVO out of the way here. We don't need that right this minute. And to start a Zoom session, all you have to do is web to the Zoom website. The URL is real hard to remember. It's zoom.us, one of the new top-level domains for the United States. I guess zoom.com was taken and probably too expensive. And you can probably guess what zoom.com will provide. I don't recommend trying that. I suspect you might see something you didn't want to. Zoom.us and sign in. Oh, I was already. Oh, I am already signed in. If you weren't signed in, you'd obviously be prompted for a username and a password. Username is usually an email address. The password we would supply to you. If you use one of our 20 accounts, we would provide you the username and password, obviously. Once you get signed in, you have a series of tabs over here. You won't have most of these because this is the management account for this group of accounts. But you will have a My Meetings tab, and that's probably where you'll get dropped right away. And in My Meetings, you'll have a personal meeting room. The access information for this personal meeting room always stays the same. So that's probably the one you want to use most of the time. And if a meeting is not already in progress, as it is here, you'll see a little button here. You probably saw me do that earlier, marked Start. And you click on that, and bang, you go into Zoom, and it looks just like what you saw when you came into this meeting. Zoom will send you a little client application that you have to run. It's harmless, and it just provides your computer with the connection it needs to Zoom. And then you, your meeting begins. You join the audio normally by joining via computer so that you keep your computer microphone and speakers. Was that a question?
I was just going to point out, when I got started, I got confused with, you know, the My Meetings on the left and on the top right. I would go, you know, I'd have a meeting, and I'd schedule a meeting, and I'd get two different numbers, and I had two meetings going, and
right.
I was confused.
Exactly. That's something I very much want to caution you about. That's why I'm suggesting that you host the meeting in this way. If you go up here to this host a meeting link, Zoom will start a meeting with a random meeting ID. And if you have given your meeting ID to your students already, they won't be able to get into that meeting.
That's what I did.
Yeah, and that's easy to do. So it's very important to start your meeting from My Meetings. And there's another reason why it's important to do that, especially if you're using a shared account. You don't necessarily want to drop right in the middle of somebody else's meeting. Though, of course, this will tell you right here. If this button says Join instead of Start, well, you know there's a meeting already in progress. You probably don't want to hop right in. But if you, let's say you're ready to start a meeting, you just decided to have a meeting, and you want to know if the other people who are using this same account might be planning to do a meeting sometime soon. Well, if they have, you should see just below your personal meeting room here a scheduled meeting or one or more scheduled meetings. You can schedule a meeting by clicking on this button right here. Very simple. You just give it a name. Whatever. You tell Zoom when you want that meeting. Be back on the 28th, so I'll pick that. At 3 p.m. is fine. Set an approximate duration. It won't hold you to that. If you decide to meet longer than that, it will shut you off. It's good to have the right time zone here. That should be right by default. You can set up recurring meetings if you like. Every week, every same day each week, and so on. You can determine whether you want your video and your participant video on initially. That's usually what you want. I give both audio options. And I would always check this used personal meeting ID so that by automatically you will use the ID that you think you're using. Also, if you want to enable join before host so that people get in there before you are, they can talk to each other. They don't have to wait on you. And if it's something where you really don't want just someone who might just have your personal meeting ID to drop in on, you can require a password for this particular meeting so that only people you have invited and provided that password to will be able to get in. And then you just schedule the meeting. And that meeting appears then under My Meetings, right below your personal meeting room, or the personal meeting room. So if you go in and you see a bunch of scheduled meetings there, just look and see if one of those is going to overlap your anticipated usage. And in that case, you'd want to respect that, first come, first serve. If that's going to be a problem, you can get in touch with us real quick, and we can provide you access to another account. So we haven't had to do that yet. I don't anticipate that being a problem. But that's all there is to starting a meeting and to scheduling a meeting. The other thing we haven't talked about, let me stop the share, is how to get to...
Dave, got
a question?
Yeah, I have a question. I have noticed that when we schedule a meeting and we set a given time, Fridays, 8 a.m.,
right.
But I've noticed that the same Zoom link is available at any time. So so there's really no reason, because I used to have with CCC Confer and Illuminate, so I had to each semester set a new time slot, all the students had to relearn, or they had to learn a new code how to access the meeting.
Right.
Like, that's not true these days, right? So I can just...
No, that is, you don't have to do that. The main reason for scheduling a meeting, if you're in a shared account, is to carve out that time for yourself so that your colleagues who are sharing that account with you will know that that's yours, and they presumably will not encroach upon it.
Well, it's always Tuesday and Wednesday, 7 o'clock. Yeah.
You can set that up as a recurring meeting if you like. But if you're using a personal account, like a free account, or if you pay for your own, if we get to the point at some point in the future where we just buy so many accounts that everybody can have their own.
Well, I got my own from...
You got your own, so you don't have to worry about that at all. Mainly the issue is, if you're sharing an account, scheduling a meeting allows you to reserve that time.
But according to Zoom, I don't have to, like, I changed my meeting to a different day and time, and the same link worked on a different...
As long as you tell it to use your personal meeting ID, that link will not change.
Okay.
Yeah. So, what do we have to do then to get people in? Well, you all saw what, you know how this works, because you got in using a link that we sent, that Jane sent you. That link can be had if you mouse over the screen again and click the, and I believe you have the invite button down at the bottom. I think you'll have that. And if you just click that, it comes up and it says you can either invite by email or instant message. Normally you do it, by, one way to do it is by email. It gives you some default email choices, or you can just copy either the URL or the full invitation to your clipboard. And I'm going to do that right now, as the buttons are in the lower left-hand corner of that box that pops up. I'm going to copy that invitation to my clipboard so I can show it to you by sharing my screen and bringing up Word or something. Let's see. One trick you learn very quickly is if you're going to be doing anything creative when you share your screen, you want to get out of full screen view before you share your screen. Otherwise, you have some limitations. That bothered me more than anything else the first couple of times. So, let me just bring up Word here or something. Let's see. Too many things on the screen. There we go. All right, here's what, let me get this out of the way. Here's what a Zoom invitation looks like. The critical things are this URL right here, and it's a good idea. Let's see if I can make that pop into a, well, for some reason it's not doing it while I'm sharing it here. Oh, probably if I close that. normally if you just put your cursor right at the end of the URL like that, hit space bar, this will turn blue and it'll turn it into an active link. If I had done something other than Word, it would have done that. But this is a URL that you can either send to someone in an email, as we did for you, or you can put this URL in a web link on a web page or in Blackboard, and just have your students click on that link, and they'll go right into your personal meeting room. That's my personal meeting room URL. The other option is to just send them the personal meeting ID, which is the tail end of the URL, that number there. They can use that number to access the session on their smartphone or their tablet, or they can go to the Zoom website, find that here, somewhere there it is, and just go to the homepage, Zoom homepage. There we are. And there's a join a meeting button on the Zoom homepage. They can just click that and type in that number. With no spaces, it doesn't have to be spaces or punctuation or anything. Just type in the number and hit join and they come right in. That's why it's so, why people are, the system is so easy to get people into. It's, the hurdle to getting in is just so much lower. Those of you who have used Blackboard Collaborate through CCC Confer or through Blackboard in the past know that it's much more complicated to get into a Blackboard Collaborate session than it is to get into Zoom. So it's much more likely that your students are going to be able to take advantage of this. Indeed, we almost never see them having a problem. One of them has a problem. You have to wonder about whether you should be there. Not going to say that. Okay. We're not going to use Zoom as a screening test. All right. So any questions about how to start a Zoom session or how to get somebody into it? Any comments about that? Ready? Oh gosh, we have lots of time left. Make something up here. Anyhow, let's see what we got left. We've gone through just about all the technical nuts and bolts several times now. Hope you can see that there's just nothing much to using Zoom in terms of technology, either in terms of the equipment you have or in terms of learning to use the thing. I will tell you that by far the best way to learn to use it is to practice with it and to actually get online and Zoom with people. We don't care if you use it to Zoom with your kids in halfway across the country. I use it sometimes to talk to my son and my grandchild in London. Works like a shot. Use it to get comfortable with it. Just play with it. So having pretty well dealt with the technical issues here, I hope, unless somebody has another question, you do, just sing out. Let's talk about the really important stuff. Is it, why would we bother? What can Zoom do for us instructionally? Love having a whiteboard. I can't teach without a whiteboard. You gotta have a whiteboard. Zoom gives you, and this is a lot better than that Zoom whiteboard because I don't have to type stuff in or paste stuff onto it. So I just use a piece of paper. As long as I've got the document camera, which, by the way, that little IPVO document camera is also about $70. So none of this stuff is especially expensive. If you want to outfit a classroom, just about everything you could possibly use, you're talking about less than $500. And that, geez, the chairs in the class, a couple of chairs cost more than that. So can't spend that on technology.
Right.
No, don't get me started. Okay, I'll be nice. All right, what can you do with Zoom? Well, here's a couple of ideas. A lot of people start off using Zoom for office hours, online office hours. Even if you teach in a face-to-face class, you can do the office hours virtually so that students don't have to come in to see you. You can start up a Zoom session and say, I'll be in the Zoom session from 7 to 8 tonight, whatever, or from 3 to 4 this afternoon, and give students the access URL, put it in your syllabus, put a link to it in Blackboard, whatever, and at that time they can just pop right in and they can talk to you just as easily as they could face-to-face. The unlikely event that two students show up at the same time, you can deal with them both at the same time without having to, unless it's something personal going on, and then you can stop the meeting, start another meeting, put a password on it, and let the student who you wish to talk to enter the password. You can do help sessions. As we see, you can present just about anything you can present in a classroom. Either something you might project on the screen behind you, you can share your screen. People can see it better. You can, with a document camera, you can draw stuff or put three-dimensional objects on the thing, whatever, and they can see it just as well as they can if you're physically present with one another. So you can work problems. You can go over important points for a test. You can put your textbook on a document under the document camera and show them things in it. You can pull up websites that have information germane to what you're talking about. Share those with them. Just about anything you can do if you have them face-to-face. And of course, as we're seeing here, if you want to go beyond that, you can do a full-up class lecture on Zoom. That's every bit as rich as what you can do in a physical classroom. And you can even bond together a physical classroom and people sitting at home on their computers or sitting on a ship in the Persian Gulf on their computer. And you can bring them all together. The only requirement is that they all be online at the same time. This is a synchronous tool. And the implications, I think, are just amazing. We can dissolve the walls of our classroom. We talk about that a lot. But what we were mainly talking about was all sharing the same Blackboard site. Okay, yeah, you can do a lot of that one. People like
it. Hey, Dave, I have a question. This is Ingrid.
Hey, Ingrid.
I do some writing tutoring with students. If a student joins Zoom remotely, would they take a picture of their paper and then I could edit it in Whiteboard?
They could send you a copy of it as an email attachment, and then you, either one of you, or they can bring it up on their screen. Presumably they're working on it in Word or something.
Or it might be handwritten.
If it's handwritten, then they're going to have some sort of document camera to share it with you. And obviously you can't, they could take a picture of it and send you the picture, but you really couldn't edit the picture.
All right.
You could mark it up. You could pull the picture up on your screen and mark it up. Talk about, oh, this sentence is a little rough, and you can, if you put it on the whiteboard, you can then, or you could annotate over it, you can draw over it, and
yeah.
you know, write them a little note. That annotation tools also have a text tool, I believe, so you can type something out for them.
Oh, nice. Yeah.
I think that's true. I better check that. But yeah, you can do that in real time. But if it's in an electronic format already, they could just bring it up in Word, and you could both see it. They could share their screen with you, and then you could see it. And there's an option in screen sharing. That you brought this up. There's an option in screen sharing that will allow you to request that the student give you control of their computer. And then you could edit the document on their computer.
Whoa.
Using your keyboard and mouse.
Can you demo that, Dave?
Yeah.
That's brilliant.
Yeah.
Okay, I'll have to share my screen.
Okay.
Let me bring up Word here. Okay, there's our meeting ID we had up there before. If you go to the top of the screen, bounce up to the top where you found that annotation menu before and so on, and there's a little button marked More. If you click on that, you'll find an option to request remote control.
Oh yeah, request remote control. Got it.
Go ahead and do that.
Okay. I submitted a request.
And I get a little pop-up that says, Ingrid Greenberg requesting remote control of your shared content. If you approve the request, Ingrid Greenberg will have access to your entire shared content. Sure you trust Ingrid to do that. No, that didn't have that in there. You can regain control at any time by clicking anywhere. So I'm going to approve that and then take my hand off the mouse.
All right. So now I'm going to, and I have a button that says click to start remote control now.
Good. Thank you. Do so. Now, Ingrid, honest to God, my hands are in the air. Ingrid is controlling my computer. She can do anything she wants. So obviously, Ingrid. Julia, unfortunately, Julia, I can only have one person do it at a time. So I'm going to have to decline that. Now, if I take my hand off the mouse again, Ingrid should have control again. And she can edit that document. She can bring up something else she wants to. She can, her keyboard and mouse, in effect, become my keyboard and mouse.
Right, and this works with any application, right, Dave?
Yeah, anything that I have up or that can be brought up. You can go down to my start button, start looking through my pictures and pull up looking for embarrassing documents and things like that. This is my personal laptop, so God knows what's on there.
Right, but so you can demo software, you can edit, you can work with somebody. It's just screen sharing like you used to be able to do.
Exactly. So we're she's just had a ball of that document.
Wow. And if I knew more about how to draw in Word, I could do some of that.
Well, right. Right. You gotta know how to do what you want to do. But you basically have full control of my computer. And not only that, but you also there you go, the markup tools in Word. Folks, we've just had a couple of visitors pop in here. Daryl, we're in a Zoom meeting, a flex session for continuing ed.
Oh, okay.
Here, let me hold a second. Ingrid's playing with my document here.
I can probably go into it.
And I don't have a projector up today. Everybody's remote. But
you can join on your phone if you want.
That's true. Well, the trick there is that having the phone show up. If you're in the I've got the screen shared like this, it won't pop up.
Right.
Also, it won't show to you unless you go into gallery view because I'm talking, so it's sending is stuck on my primary display right now.
We'll come back to you later.
All right. I'm sorry. I'll be done at 3:30.
Okay.
No, it's 1:15. Okay. Or you can just wait. I'd love to have you just...
We're not in a rush.
Join us. Oh, wait a minute. What am I thinking about? Katie's here.
Katie's here?
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Just come on for it. Just don't trip over the wire.
You want to take your keys?
I hate to lose you there. And like I said, Glenn, you've hit the right button. Request remote control, but still going to town here.
yeah, this is very cool.
I can't get it back.
I like the new comments. We can type in ideas.
So I could not make a better example of this in any way. You're showing very effectively how this could be so powerful. And if this were another piece of software, if you're showing someone how to use Camtasia, say, or something like that, you could give them control and they could actually run Camtasia on your computer. And you just sit there and watch them and help them out. And you can go back and forth. If I click somewhere on the document, I retake control.
Okay. Go ahead, take control back.
I just did. So now I control the horizontal, I control the vertical. Everybody remembers the outer limits, right?
So could you go under the review tab and add a comment now?
Geez, can I remember how to do that? New comment.
Oh, click somewhere on the doc, yeah.
Yeah, click somewhere on the international numbers available. New comment.
Okay.
Watch for phone bills. International numbers are not free. As a matter of fact, neither of those numbers that you see here are free. This one is a San Francisco number. That won't cost you too much. This one's a New York City number. We haven't paid for the toll-free number. So beware. If you're using your cell phone, you're probably not going to get long distance charges, but you will, of course, use minutes. So, let's see. Let me, Glenn, if you go ahead and request again, I'll let you, I declined your request before, but if you request again, I'll improve.
No, that's okay. I just wanted to see somebody else add a comment.
Okay, well, you see.
Document simultaneously.
That's all there is to it. It's just a dialogue. People can't take control of your screen unless you let them do so. If I wanted to take control of one of your all screens, I'd have to ask you too. I can't do that even as the moderator. But if you let me do that.
But it's full control of your computer, your mouse, and keyboard?
Absolutely.
So there's no way to limit access to the current application or something like that?
You can share just the current application instead of sharing the entire desktop. So in that event, yes, they would hit. But I suspect they could probably break out, but I haven't actually tried that. But I suspect they could. I imagine so.
That's really great if we're teaching software and a student has a question.
Yeah, think about it.
You can share online the application, and then you both could work on the same document at the same time.
Yeah, if you're coding or writing, as Ingrid was showing, you could
mark this is exciting while
they're working on it. And that's, you can do that. If they come into your office with the document printed out on paper, you can blue pencil it. But this is even better. They keep it. You can do just about anything you could do if they were present, and they don't have to get in the car and drive to see you and show up late, things like that. It's, if you can think of something you can do face-to-face that would be approved by the district, that you can't do on Zoom, I'd like to hear it.
Hmm. Awesome.
you have to think about it. I'm sure there are things, but you have to think hard to think of it. You can do most anything you need to do while communicating on Zoom like this. It's just amazing. Amazing what you can do. I'm sorry, I get excited about this. This is one of my favorite things. And the thing I see that just has the most potential, because we can dissolve our classrooms, the walls of our classrooms, and bring people in who can be anywhere in the world, as long as they have access to a reasonably decent internet connection. And Zoom's pretty modest, has modest requirements about that. Even a cellular connection, as I said, will work pretty well most times, unless you drop a cell or something like that. And think about what that does for, say, blended learning.
There, I switched to a microphone that's a little more a little more me-oriented. Drawback, the big drawback with blended learning, hybrid classes, is that students have to travel to get to your classroom for the part of your course that is offered face-to-face. And that cuts out a certain population, military students around the world, students in other states or in other localities. They, up to now, have been limited to taking fully online classes that were offered entirely asynchronously through Blackboard or some other learning management system. Zoom eliminates that problem. Students can participate synchronously in real time, every bit as richly as they can participate if their butt's in a chair in front of you using Zoom, and not have to be there, not have to travel. So suddenly you can run these synchronous classes or classes that are asynchronous and synchronous, and you can bring in students who are anywhere in the world. They don't have to be in San Diego.
Dave, just to interject, for non-credit education, we actually can only accept California residents. So I just wanted to
come in with that. Indeed. The only limitations are procedural and legislative, or statutory. There are things we're not allowed to do. But Zoom knocks down the technical barriers. So you can still bring in people who are in California, right there, or are you limited to the San Diego metropolitan area?
Again, it goes back to procedure. Because of some procedures in place, we're not going to have students that far out of San Diego.
Right. So those are issues, certainly, that have to be adhered, or those are rules that have to be adhered to. But in circumstances where those rules do not apply, you can spread your you can spread education as far as you like. It's almost like a synchronous MOOC. You can have up to 100 people, indeed, if you want to pay for it, up to 200 people in a classroom at the same time. And you can have people physically present, and you can have up to 200 people coming in remotely, and they can be anywhere in the world. That's power. That's reach. That's an extension of what we can do now. And yet the experience that they get synchronously is quality-wise just as good, I would maintain, as what they get if their butts are in a chair sitting in front of you, and in some ways better, because they can see and they can hear better than they can in the classroom. In many cases.
Dave, this is Emma.
Emma.
Hi.
Hi there.
So it can be, these sessions can be recorded as well.
I'm recording this one right now.
Right. And students, and you can display those on a website and they can go back and
yeah. Typically, we upload them to YouTube.
YouTube, okay. Yeah.
If we don't want to share it with the world, we just mark the YouTube video
private. Yeah.
Not yeah. private usually.
Oh no.
Unless it's really sensitive.
Uh huh.
But unlisted.
Unlisted. Yeah.
Just about as good because they can't view it unless they know the URL and they can't guess the URL. So you only people to whom you give the URL can watch. And that's so we put our, but we put most things up public because they may be of interest to people outside the SDCCD.
Uh-huh, okay.
But we're sensitive to that, yes.
Can I ask you a question about the accounts?
I hope you will.
Well, there's the Zoom account that you go to zoom.com or zoom.us.
Mm-hmm.
Or you can go to CCC Confer Zoom, and then you can go to the school URL. And how does that all work?
Okay. Yeah, there's a number of ways to get a Zoom account. One is to just go to zoom.us and sign up for free. That free account, the only limitation relative to the pro account is that your meetings can only last 40 minutes. And that's your personal account, doesn't have anything to do with anybody else. You can also go to confernow.org. Let me share that screen.
So those Zoom accounts are $15 a month if you pay for it?
If you pay for it, right. But at, from confernow.org, this is run by CCC Confer.
Uh-huh.
Our state chancellor's office supported initiative through Palomar College, you can get a free account here. Originally, they were giving out pro accounts, but I've had people tell me who have signed up for this recently that they're now giving out free Zoom accounts. So the only major reason to do this instead of just going and signing up for your own account at zoom.us is that it puts you into a group of people statewide who are connected and you can message with them and things like that. So if you're going to get a free account, I'd go through ConferNow.
You know, I went through ConferNow and I couldn't get a free account.
You couldn't get an account at all or you couldn't get
a free? I got an account, but it's like the 40-minute one.
That's what I mean. That's the free account.
Oh, okay. That's the free one. Okay.
That's the free account.
All right. So that's from ConferNow.
They were giving out pro accounts at first.
Right. And I think Claudia got one of those.
Yeah, Claudia got in there early.
Yeah. Good old Claudia.
No grass growing under her feet. But I think they ran out. It got so popular that they ran out of pro accounts. And Zoom will let them give out any number of free accounts. Because Zoom gives those out. But getting the free account through ConferNow still connects you with the California Community Colleges, so it's worth doing that way.
Thank you.
The pro accounts, you have two options. If you don't want to be limited to 40 minutes at a time, you can ask us for access to one of our shared pro accounts. We're happy to provide it.
That's free?
That's free. Well, it's free to you. We pay for it. But it's free to you.
Right.
And you can use it as much as you like. You just have to share it with, right now, on average, most of the accounts have three or four people using them. But that sounds more restricted than it is. I've got accounts that haven't been used in a couple of months. I go through and look occasionally, and I shift people around. If somebody's using it a lot, and are using an account a lot, I'll shift people who are not using it out into another account and so on, so that the person who's using it a lot has more freedom.
Yeah.
But there really haven't been any problems, any conflicts so far that have reached me anyway.
Right. So theoretically then, if you were going to do a synchronous class that meets once a week,
right,
go and get that class and establish that meeting time, whatever, like on Wednesdays at 3 o'clock for an hour, and have that meeting time saved and scheduled, and then you do your synchronous meeting at that point, at that time.
No, be no trouble.
No cost to us.
No cost to you. No cost to continuing ed. No cost to the faculty member.
Okay.
You're paying for it.
All right.
And we're not paying a lot. That's why we can afford to do that. It's not like we have suitcase full of money over here. It's just that it's not very expensive. And if you want your own personal, ain't nobody else going to touch it account, pro account, you can go in and you can sign up for it through Zoom.us. And it costs you $15 a month, which I say, like I say, is about what you pay for HBO Go. Mm-hmm. And it's a lot more fun.
Hey, Dave, do you know if the basic account offers screen sharing?
Oh, yeah. The basic account offers everything that you see here today. The only difference between the basic account or the free account, the basic free basic account, and the one I'm using today is that I'm not limited to 40 minutes.
Mm-hmm.
I bet you wish I was. You wouldn't still be here. You'd be, oh, we'd be all over. No, it's that's the only difference. You got screen sharing. You got multiple cameras, multiple microphone capability. Everything you want to do can be done through the basic account. You just, your meetings can only last 40 minutes at a time. And your people, if you want to go longer than 40 minutes, you have to start another meeting and your attendees have to come back in. You just click on the link again. You know, you break it 40 minutes. Say, let's take 10 minutes and come back in and I'll have a new meeting started. Same URL, just click on the link again and we'll get back together. So we could get by with a free account quite nicely. And Michelle, I'll just make this offer if you're still there. I'm not in gallery view right now. But matter of fact, I don't need
to
share my screen. If we had a pilot running and we wanted to carve out an account that was exclusive to that pilot, I'm sure we could manage.
Yes, I was actually going to ask that question. Once we determine exactly how many we have, that we could probably do something to help us out there. Yeah.
Yeah, I'll carve you out a pilot.
Yeah.
Sure enough. I can do that. I got the password.
Awesome.
Great questions, folks. God, I love this. This is, I'd rather do this than go in there and sift through my emails that have come in. So keep asking questions. I'll keep answering them as long as you got them.
I was curious if Don Aragon is still on.
Yeah, he appears to be. Don?
He's been, hi, Don. I know you've been doing some of your lectures using CCC Confer. I'm curious how this compares just based on what you've heard or any of the issues or positive experience you've had with CCC Confer.
Good question.
Well, the stuff that we've done in CCC Confer, because of the way we're doing things, have been workable. Of course, there's always glitches, as you know. This interface certainly is cleaner. There's no question about that. Again, from my standpoint, the only questions I would have would be how we would really track students' attendance and viewing the videos. And so far, we do have some of that with CC Confer, but you know, we still want to be able to maintain the integrity of our classes. In other words, share to the world would be a big problem, which is the default, of course, and having a robust way to track student attendance for watching these videos. That would be the only comments I have right now.
Yeah, the in terms of somebody outside getting in, if you don't share the meeting ID, which you can change, the person's meeting ID can be changed. You can prevent anybody else from coming in, just as you can with Blackboard Collaborate. You can also, as you can with Collaborate, put a password on the meeting so that people have to have that to get in. So that's not a problem with Zoom. Zoom doesn't really have any attendance tracking tools per se. If you notice that when I started, I asked everyone to introduce themselves. Partly that was because I wanted everyone to know who their colleagues were who were online. The other part is I can go back later and I can tell who attended. So I won't know, of course, if somebody dropped out halfway through, and I don't think Collaborate has any way to tell you that either.
Yes, actually it does in the reports.
Oh, it does in the reports, okay.
And the other thing that I would be concerned with, how about people who can't get to the session? whether they watch the session or not.
Right. Depends on how you make the recording available. One way to do that would be to make it available in Blackboard and set statistics tracking to on.
Okay.
On the link, and then you'll know who's clicked on the link. And we're about to get much better analytics for Blackboard. We're looking at installing that over the summer, and you're going to have much better information about who's looked at what, how long they've spent at it, and how many people have looked at it, things like that. So that's coming.
Okay.
Anything else? Did I miss something there?
No, I think I understand what you're saying.
Yeah, the experience, I think you can see with Zoom, is so much richer for the students and for you than it is with Collaborate. Blackboard realizes this, and they're actually upgrading Collaborate. They're producing what's called Collaborate Ultra that is very similar to what you're seeing with Zoom, except that it's not fully baked yet. They've been working on it for about 2.5 years, 3 years now, and they don't really have a viable product yet. And if when they do, it'll be an option through CCC Confer, but it ain't ready yet. And Zoom is here and is maturing all the time and is taking a bigger market share all the time and so on. So I'd be worried if I had a lot of investments in Blackboard Collaborate. This is just an entirely different experience and easier for both the instructor and the students to make use of. Anybody else? Anything else? I'll just mention here that what you're seeing behind me is Sand Dollar Beach, Big Sur. I'd like to tell you I have a little cottage with a window that looks like that, but one of the things we can do in our studio here is live chroma key. I'm, of course, sitting in front of a green screen, and I can put myself anywhere, and it doesn't have just to be an aesthetic. I could bring up a PowerPoint presentation behind me and stand up if I tilt the camera a little bit or scooch down, and I can interact with whatever is going on behind me live in real time. Now that is something that is probably not going to be set up except in a very high-end smart classroom. The live keyer that I'm using is about the cheapest one you can buy, and it's about $1,300. But it does add another dimension, another level of visual interest to what you're doing, and instructional capability as well, because you can interact in real time. You can do the weatherman thing, though I will tell you that's not nearly as easy as it looks on TV. Figuring out which hand to use and seeing and pointing at things and so on, because everything's reversed, is really kind of challenging. But it's a lot of fun too. It's a lot of fun just to come to people from a different place from time to time.
Dave, I just had one thing to mention. I just sent out an email to everyone with our next steps in the process. There'll be a couple of next step emails that come out. But if you don't get an email from me, let me know. But I believe I got everyone who's certainly on this call or has communicated with me over the last couple of months. I have a form that I've developed so I can get some information from you so that we can appropriately look at any additional training we might need, as I mentioned at the beginning of the call. So I'll look forward to your response, and we'll be moving forward as quickly as we can. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Very interesting. Thank you.
You bet. And this will be, the recording will be online early next week. I will also have the chat log saved, and I will add a link to the list for Zoom Classroom to that chat log so that you can find that document if you need it.
Any last questions?
Dave?
Yes.
That handout with all the equipment, did you say you're going to put a link to that?
I will. As a matter of fact, I'll do that right now.
Great. Thanks.
Hey, Dave, I got to run, but thanks very much. It's been very helpful. I just got a personal account. So,
thanks, Glenn, for coming again. It's wonderful to see you.
All right. See you guys.
Thanks, Glenn.
Yeah.